Today we're going to talk about the MCAT Psychology and Sociology section. Many students took psychology early on in college and have not yet taken a sociology class. In addition, many students who have taken practice exams find themselves getting lost in the way that the AAMC asks psych-soc questions. If that sounds like you, you're not alone. I'm Vikram Shah, MCAT expert and 528 MCAT scorer. In this video, we'll go over the study strategies you can use to skyrocket your MCAT psychology and sociology score. I'll tell you what topics are on the exam, how to not only memorize but also understand key vocab terms you'll encounter on your exam, and how to study your mistakes so that you don't make them again on test day. Let's get started. What's actually on the psych-soc section of the MCAT? The MCAT Psychology and Sociology section will test your knowledge of key concepts in the fields of psychology and sociology. Like Chem Phys and Bio-Biochem, Psych-Soc contains 59 questions that you must answer in 95 minutes. 44 of these questions are based on 10 passages, while 15 questions are standalone. According to the AAMC, the Psych-Soc section of the MCAT is composed of 65% introductory psychology, 30% introductory sociology, and 5% introductory biology. Many students haven't learned the distinction between psychology and sociology, so they're unsure where to start when they begin studying. You can think of it like this. Psychology often involves individuals and how they think in certain situations, while sociology takes a more zoomed out approach and looks at society or certain parts of society as a whole. It is the difference between looking at you and your personality, which is psychology, versus patterns present among individuals in your school or workplace, which is sociology. The MCAT Psychology and Sociology section is also the last section of your exam, so you'll be tired. However, by practicing the study strategies from this video, you'll be able to handle the section and reach your goal score. Now, let's look at the topics you're going to be tested on during this section of the exam. After that, we will cover tips you can use to maximize your psych-soc score. Let's first look at the psychology topics on the exam. Topic number one is cognition and language. Topic number two covers emotion. Topic number three is memory. Topic number four is learning, and topic number five is stress. A question from topic two on emotion might ask you about the different theories of emotion, such as Cannon Bard versus James Lang. Psychology topic number six is motivation and personality, and topic number seven covers psychological disorders. Those are the main psychology topics you will see covered on the MCAT, but they may ask questions that relate to biology or sociology. Now, let's cover three biology-oriented topics you will see on the psychology and sociology section. Topic number one covers the biological basis of behavior. Topic number two covers consciousness. Topic number three covers sensation. And topic number four covers perception. These questions may ask you how a certain neurotransmitter affects an individual's emotional state, or what brain structure is involved in higher-level thinking. Finally, let's look at the sociology-oriented topics on the MCAT Psychology and Sociology section before we dive into effective study strategies. Topic number one covers social psychology, or how individuals behave and think in group settings. Topic number two covers social structures and interactions. And topic number three covers social demographics. These final two topics take a more zoomed-out approach in which you'll need to know common trends and patterns present in society as a whole. Now that you know what you're going to be tested on, let's go over tips and study strategies you can use to get the most out of your MCAT Psychology and Sociology section. MCAT Psych-Soc tip number one. Know any vocab words that show up on practice questions you take and write down the ones you don't know. Many questions on the Psych-Soc section test your ability to distinguish between a set of terms. Let's say you get the following question on your exam. After a tornado, a student claims that she knew it was coming several months before it happened. This is an example of A, hindsight bias, B, representativeness heuristic, C, availability heuristic, or D, cognitive dissonance. If you don't know what the definition of these words are, you will not be able to answer this question correctly. In this case, the answer is hindsight bias, which describes a fallacy where a person believes they knew something was going to occur, when in reality, there's no way that they could have made that prediction. If you didn't know what hindsight bias meant before this question, you would likely find answering the question correctly very difficult. So, anytime you get a psych-soc question and you don't know the definition of a term, write it down on a piece of paper, Word document, Excel sheet, Quizlet set, Anki deck, or whatever centralized location is easiest for you. Writing the term and definition down, however, is not quite enough to get all MCAT questions right, especially when you get to trickier terms that never seem to stick, no matter how many times you try to memorize them. This brings us to tip number two. When you define a psych-soc vocabulary term, include it with an example that makes sense to you. What is an example of hindsight bias? The example can come directly from the question itself. So we would write down hindsight bias, when an individual or group believes that they knew something was going to occur, when in reality, there's no way that they could have made that prediction. Example, after a tornado, a student claims that she knew it was coming several months before it happened. Utilize the already written out AAMC practice questions to your advantage. Going back to our example, we would also want to define and write down an example for our other answer choices, especially if we did not know what they already meant. Let's now look at another study strategy you can use to improve your MCAT psych-soc score. Before moving on to tip number three, we will cover an overall MCAT tip that you have likely already heard before, and this tip will be extremely important to your success on the exam. MCAT overall super important tip. Anytime you take a practice question or passage, always be sure to go back and thoroughly review the passage and the questions, even the ones you answer correctly. As a general rule of thumb, you should spend almost as much time reviewing the passage as you spend taking the passage. Vince Lombardi, a famous football coach, once said, "Practice doesn't make perfect, perfect practice makes perfect." In other words, practice involves taking as many passages as you can. Perfect practice involves taking passages, reviewing your mistakes, writing down what you need to learn, and studying to make sure you don't make those same mistakes again. Now, let's move on to our next MCAT psych-soc specific tip. So here's tip number three. Anytime you get to a passage with a graph or a figure, make sure you go back and review it very thoroughly. During your actual exam and while you take practice, you will often not have time to fully understand every graph or figure that was presented. In fact, you should not spend too much time on any one given figure unless a specific question is asking about it. Once you finish taking the passage, however, you should make sure to go back and understand every part of every graph or figure in the passage. What's the value in this? The more perfect practice you get analyzing graphs or figures without a time crunch, the better you'll be able to quickly analyze them when there is a time crunch. Finally, let's look at our last study strategy for the MCAT Psychology and Sociology section. Tip number four, practice identifying the independent, dependent, and control groups within experiments mentioned in the passages. In addition to vocab and being able to apply the vocab, the AAMC really likes to test students on psychology and sociology experiments. Students who have a great grasp of the vocab may still struggle on experiment-style questions because it is often easy to get lost in these complex experiments. Our tip is to practice identifying and writing down the key components of any experiment. What are the researchers changing on purpose? That is our independent variable. What are the researchers measuring as an outcome? That is our dependent variable. And what must the researchers hold constant in order for the results to hold true? Those are the controls. Let's look at the following example to practice identifying important experimental variables. In a study, researchers want to retrospectively assess the effects of air quality on rates of cardiovascular disease in elderly patients. Group 1 contains patients currently between the ages of 60 and 65 who lived at least 8 years within city limits in a city with a population above 1 million people while they were between 40 and 50 years old. They compare this to Group 2, which includes patients between the ages of 60 and 65 who lived at least 8 years within city limits in a city with a population below 200,000 people while they were between 40 and 50 years old. Which of the following is a potential confounding variable that the researchers did not control for? A, the effect of air quality in the city, B, the size of the city, C, socioeconomic status, and D, the number of years lived in the city. Now, before we answer this question, let's identify our important experimental variables. What are the researchers changing on purpose? The only difference between group 1 and group 2 is the size of the city that the patients lived in. So, size of the city is our independent variable, and the researchers are using city size as an indirect measure of air quality. They make the assumption that a bigger city has worse air quality. Therefore, answer choices A and B are incorrect as they describe the independent variable of the study in different ways. Let's now think about the dependent variable. What are the researchers measuring as an outcome? As the question states, the researchers are measuring rates of cardiovascular disease. Finally, what are the researchers holding constant across both group 1 and group 2? Each group has patients between 60 and 65 years old, and each group lived at least 8 of 10 years between the ages of 40 and 50 in their respective city. Let's look at answer choice D, the number of years lived in the city. The researchers accounted for this by specifying at least 8 years, so that is not our correct answer. Now, let's look at answer choice C. By process of elimination, we know that this is our correct answer, but let's take a closer look. At any point in the study, did the researchers account for socioeconomic status? If you answered no, you are correct. In order for the researchers to account for socioeconomic status, they would have needed to look at household income or another proxy variable. So answer choice C is our correct answer choice here. Use this exercise as an example of how to analyze the experiments that the AAMC will give you on the MCAT Psychology and Sociology section. Every time you see an experiment in this section, practice this exercise and you will master experiment-based MCAT Psychology and Sociology questions in no time. To review, here are the study strategies and takeaway points from this video. Takeaway number one, know any vocab words that show up on practice questions you take and write down the ones you don't know or just barely know. Takeaway number two, when you define a psych-soc vocabulary term, include with it an example that makes sense to you. Takeaway number three, anytime you get a passage with a graph or a figure, make sure you go back and review it very thoroughly. Takeaway number four, practice identifying the independent, dependent, and control groups within experiments mentioned in the passages. And the most important, takeaway number five, anytime you take a practice question or passage, always be sure to go back and thoroughly review the passage and the questions, even the ones you answered correctly. If you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up and subscribe so you don't miss out on new videos. And if you'd like to receive a free MCAT question of the day to get every last bit of practice in before your exam, click the link in the description. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time.